Hello TaleForges! In today's material we will cover the extremely important topic of animations in ECS. As of today, unfortunately, there is no official support for animations. However, with the help of a hybrid approach and managed components, I will show how to implement animations. The Unity Asset Store has great packages for ECS with bursts and job support for animations, which I highly recommend. Okay, so let's dive in and see how to implement animations in ECS. First, my graphic designer prepared three animations: idle, running, and jumping. All graphics are in PNG format. Of course, in the settings, I choose sprite, 2D, and UI. Next, I prepared the animation clips I needed for the player animator controller. I created the clips by dragging the animation frames I was interested in. In the player animator controller, I created three states: idle, run, and jump. Let's start with jump. It is handled by the jump trigger and returns to idle after execution. The transition has the exit time option checked, but all other parameters are set to 0. Idle is combined with run, in both cases exit time is disabled and transition duration is set to 0.25. I also added a parameter, run, which I set from the ECS code and which allows me to switch between idle and run states. Here is conditions configuration. That's it on the animation side. Let's move on to the ECS scene and select player. Since there is no direct support for animation in ECS, the solution is to separate the visual part from the logic. With this in mind, I remove sprite renderer from player, so only physic body, physic shape and player offering left, and added the entire visual part, it as sprite renderer and animator, to the player visualization object, from which I create a prefab. This allows me to weld the visual object from the ECS code, while leaving the logic object in the subscene. Alright, let's move on to the code. To implement the animation, we need a component with the player visualization and a component that stores the animator. Let's create a new class, PlayerVisualizationComponentData, iComponentData, which will hold the game object player visualization. Since it is a class, we are dealing with the managed type. Similarly, let's create a PlayerAnimationComponentData class that implements the iCleanupComponentData interface. The component labeled cleanup is not destroyed when the entity is destroyed, so it requires manual removal. In case the player entity is destroyed, I want to make sure that its visualization is also destroyed, which I will handle in the PlayerAnimationCleanupSystem. Now let's add serialize field and a getter with the player visualization to player offering. Then let's add component object and pass the game object player visualization in Baker. This will allow us to spawn the player visualization from within the AI system. Let's go back to Unity. Let's go to the player prefab and pass player visualization to the player model. Earlier I created a basic implementation of player visualization system, which we can develop in the material. So let's add a player entity query field and then in the onCreate method write player entity query equals to systemapi.queryBuilder with all player visualization component data, because we want to retrieve the player visualization component we added to the scene via Baker. And with none, PlayerAnimationComponentData, because we want to block repeated execution of this system once PlayerAnimation has been respawned. Don't forget to call build. Now add state.requireForUpdate PlayerEntityQuery so that onUpdate is only called when the query conditions are met. In onUpdate, let's retrieve the entity and player visualization component data. Let's create the visualization via object.instantiate player visualization component data.playerVisualization. Now we can add the player animation component data component via entity command buffer. So let's copy the method from player movement system and paste it into the visualization system. Of course, add require for update for ECB. In onUpdate, write ECB equals get entity command buffer ref state. Then ECB add component player entity new player animation component data and pass the animator, which we will retrieve from the newly created game object via get component. Okay, we have our player visualization on scene. Well done. Now it is time for the animation system. Here too, I have prepared the basic structure of the system in order to focus on the specifics. Importantly, we update the system in the simulation group, order equals first, so that the each jump change in the player movement system will be registered and we will get the correct, updated each jump state at the start of the next frame and before the player movement system is executed. In onCreate, let's create an entity query. We will need local transform to synchronize position, rotation and scale, player movement component data to read whether movement is occurring, and player animation component data. Of course, add state.requireForUpdate. So let's get these parameters in onUpdate by referring to entity query and get singleton. Cache transform from player visualization via animator.transform. Transform.position equals to playerLocalTransform.position. TransformRotation equals to playerLocalTransform.rotation. Let's cache uniform scale from playerLocalTransform.scale. Transform.scale equals to new vector 3 scale. And now we want to handle two checks. The first one where we check whether the player is grounded and is jump. For this we use pattern matching with is keyword. Then we set the jump trigger on the animator. Apart from that, we also want to handle the situation where the player goes from idle to run or from run to idle animations. We use setBool method with parameter run with the value mat.absolute player movement component data.direction greater than 0. Let's go back to Unity, recompile, press play. As you can see, jumping is working correctly. But what if I delete a player entity in runtime? Let's check. Go to player movement system and add the destruction of player entity when jumping. I think it is the simplest way in our code. Recompile, press play, jump, and you can see that we get errors. And this is due to the fact that we keep referring to a component that has not been removed from the player. What is more, the player visualization has remained on scene and we have no control over it. Okay, all that remains is to clean up this mess. Let's create player animation entity query variable, and in onCreate write player animation entity query equals system API query builder with all player animation component data. This component need to be manually removed, and with none player component data local transform, so we know that player entity was destroyed if these components are missing. Let's copy paste entity command buffer code from player visualization system. Now we just need to get the entity and player animation component data from player animation entity query. Destroy game object, that is the player visualization, and remove component player animation component data via ECB. Also add the missing required for update. Let's see if this works. Recompile. Press play. Jump to destroy entity and voila! Everything works as expected. I warmly invite you to support us on the Patreon, where I share the code from the recordings and post the ECS videos beforehand. And to all the supporters, thank you. We really appreciate your support. Thank you for your time. In the next materials, we'll focus on the camera operation and the user interface. So stay tuned.